Welcome to the Hollywood Outsider, an award-winning weekly entertainment podcast. In this episode, we'll be reviewing Cocaine Bear and the new Children of the Corn, but our topic this week is man versus nature. Why are we so terrified of everything that isn't quite us? Well, that's a loaded question, isn't it? Let's get on with the show. My name is Aaron Peterson. Joining me today, my fellow host, John Davenport.
Hey, buddy. How the hell are you tonight?
I am ecstatic. Troy Heinrichs.
Oh, wow. I got moved up in the
That's
list.
That's right.
I'm so excited.
And Amanda
See what happens when you show up more?
Hello, hello.
That's what happens. Troy's been putting in the hours, boy. He's done so many podcasts in the last 24 hours. So
just in the last
he
day.
Really has.
Exactly.
Poor guy. It's really not fair.
He's making choices.
Hey, I was happy to fill in for Scott on the half hour power hour. It's just that episode was the worst episode of the first season of The Last of Us.
Yeah, it was very disappointing.
The most recent one with Riley, is that the one you're speaking of?
Yes.
I don't know why that's bad. It was
still good. It just wasn't as good as the others because it was so much focus on story development.
Oh, God forbid we have story.
I'm sorry,
we don't want any story or character development. That's shame on us. We need things attacking at all times.
I'll go on record and be very clear. It has nothing to do with the relationship.
It's not what I heard.
The two
it's not the story
people.
I started on Facebook and Twitter and everywhere else I could find. Reddit.
That's not the story he started.
It's not what I heard.
It is also 100 times better than other network TV that is on Sunday night. So it's
right.
Even though it was the worst episode of the season for The Last of Us, it's still way better than anything else you would have seen on Sunday.
Yeah, it's still pretty good television. I just like the fact that Aaron's hinting at starting fights on the internet over over certain topics.
I can't believe you. Can't believe you.
I didn't realize you were so homophobic.
No, why do you have to see when you use a word, that's not funny. Then it stops being funny. Stops being funny.
See, now it's true, so it's funny. Or not funny,
you know what?
Anymore.
We don't speak into that. Let's talk about Hogwarts Legacy and how that sold over 12 million copies in just a few weeks. So
I think 100 million of those are mine, or 10 million of those are mine.
Why did you
Something
buy
like
so
that.
Many copies and how?
I just kept on deciding that I was going to buy more because I just was so tired of all the bad press. So I was like, screw it. I'm just going to keep buying it until people shut up.
So you just made a very large investment without any return? We need to talk about your financial decisions.
It's like we don't
if
know what
I don't
jokes
take
are.
Them out of the box, they go up in value. Is that what that happens, right?
It's very true. This one will definitely go up in value.
No, it won't. When was the last time a game really went up in value? I mean, really? Like,
no,
of
they
recent
always
years.
Decrease.
They always decrease. Because they're too mass-produced.
Talk to those guys on the go that are collecting all those damn NES cartridges that are like $10,000.
That's because they were rare. Everything today is not rare. Everybody can
they're
get it.
They're sold out
they
for
want.
Hogwarts, though. They've been sold out.
I can get one. I just bought one. And sent it to
you
my
literally
son.
Can't
I just
sell out with digital
It was
download.
Literally a PS5 that I just bought and sent to my son.
GameStop's
It literally came
people.
Here because I put the wrong address on it and I shipped it to him. I got it in like a few days. So yeah,
well,
it's there.
Then
Sorry.
GameStop be lying.
Stop listening to the hype. They're trying to make you want to buy a game. That's all it is.
Wait, did I just hear you bought your son a PS5?
Game. I did not buy my son a PS5. No.
I was going to say, what do I have to do to be your kid?
Aaron's not that crazy, yo.
No. No, yo.
Or generous. I don't know if he's like, let me just get you a PS5 because you exist.
I do think it's unfair. I mean, I did get Aaron an Xbox Series X, but
I took
it for free.
I paid for half of it out of guilt.
But for him, it was free.
Yeah.
What is happening in Chicago right now?
He Hang gave in. You no. a free gift that he received
he
as a free
no,
gift.
No, he could have profited off of it, so he did give that to me. Yeah.
Okay.
That's back when they were hot properties, too.
Aaron actually helped me out because we basically said we have two, so we each paid $250. Mm-hmm. So that we did pay for one, but yes, I had two shipped to my house, and Microsoft said, our bad, just keep it.
And that's when they
that's
were
a piss
shortage.
A lot of people
that's
off.
When there was a shortage. Nobody could get them. And it's like, wow.
Yeah, that was on release day. Like, I had two in my house on release day.
Isn't that awesome?
Like, the guy comes off the FedEx truck carrying two boxes. And I'm like, do I have to assemble this thing? It's so freaking big. Like, what's the deal? And I open it up, and sure as shit, I had two of them.
There's somebody listening right now who tried for two Christmases to get one of these, mm-hmm. and they're just going to do like a little voodoo thing with you later.
Yeah. Yeah. Troy, tell me when your back starts to hurt.
No problem. My email is John at the Hollywood.
I don't even think that's my email address. I forgot what it was already.
I think
again.
It is. But you should probably
You don't
know.
Check it anyway, so it doesn't matter.
Right. Well, I can. Right. I just don't launch Outlook on my recording computer anymore, and that's the only place I can check it.
You can check it on your phone.
Let's come. Like the rest okay, of us. Let's come back. No, seriously, I can't have another. John doesn't know how to use his email discussion. I just can't do it. Amanda, you're playing this Hogwarts.
What's email?
You're playing this Hogwarts Legacy game.
Yeah.
Which is Harry Potter related, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have to love the movies or the books to understand it?
Not at all.
I do not care anything about Harry Potter.
No, not at all. I do wonder, like, if you hate the world, the wizarding world, I don't know that you'll enjoy this because
I said don't care. I didn't say hate.
I'm just saying for in general for people. So if someone really doesn't like the wizarding world, you're probably not going to enjoy it from that standpoint. But does it revolve around specifically Harry Potter, Hermione, Ron, or Newt Scamander? No. Like, you have a different story that... It doesn't even, at least for as far as I've gotten into so far, doesn't even make necessarily those references. There's like a couple smaller things that you may notice like here and there. But other than that, it's just the wizarding world brought to you for you to live in and go through the story and the different side quests.
Oh, kind of like a universe where you don't have to mention a certain last name every freaking time you make a show. They've actually done that. So even though what? Harry Potter was a complete ripoff of Star Wars from a story perspective, like at least they got that part right.
Is that where you're going? You're,
there was also a baby delivered to a doorstep.
Do you not know the similarities between
no,
Star Wars
I do
and
know,
Harry Potter?
I know there's similarities, but you said it's a ripoff, and I would say that that's a little bit of a stretch.
Yeah, I would.
Star Wars came out first. I'm just saying.
Doesn't matter.
I mean, Star Wars, Troy, I just got to be honest. Star Wars is not that complicated of a goddamn script. It's really not.
It sure is.
It's not. I mean, I know they got complicated as George Lucas went, but they're not typically that complicated.
But they got more complicated? It seemed like they got easier as it went along.
Well, yeah. He's funging it. Yeah.
Oh, John's got a Star Wars point. He's raising his hand.
I am raising my hand, and I'm raising my hand just so that I can let everybody know that I just opened my email, and there were only 110 unread emails in the Hollywood Outsider email.
Nice job, buddy. Good job.
John, this is not the topic you were looking for.
Oh, what was the topic again? Oh, were we talking about Star Wars being the same story as Harry Potter again? Because that's...
You don't get to talk about repeating topics. I've heard about your email like 400 times in the last year alone. We get it. You don't want to read them. I got it. It's fine.
I can't read, Aaron. Why are you making me feel like a less of a human being for not being able to read?
This is feeling very victim-y.
You know what? That's a good segue. Speaking of victims, Creed 3 is out. Do any of you guys like boxing films? And if so, what's the appeal? If not, why not? Where do we land with people smashing each other in the face?
I mean, I've been waiting for the documentary from Amazon to see what happens inside the warehouse.
Shit. I just can't with you.
Oh, my
today.
God. That was so good.
So I'll say from my perspective, I've never Please. Been big into boxing. And it's not a slight to... I don't even want to call it a sport because I have very mixed feelings on it.
It is a sport.
According
to people.
It's an Olympic sport and women's softball is not. That is a crime.
Let me say that I personally struggle with watching MMA and boxing.
If I let you say it, does that make me progressive?
No.
Okay.
Also, MMA is not boxing.
I said MMA and boxing. Can you let the woman finish? God damn. Would you like to speak for me?
Yes.
Because it seems like you do.
The masculinity bus over because the feminist is about to drive.
I guess we're okay when the woman interrupts us constantly, but if we do it, my God, we're just misogyny.
I'm interrupted quite often as well. But anyway, so...
I'm just not used to hearing the voice.
That's only because there's no way to talk if we don't.
Yeah.
So for MMA and boxing, I struggle with it because I've always found it bizarre that we bring these individuals who, for even if they're, you know, they're consensually engaging in this activity, but to me, it's like we're rallying around... people busting each other's face up. To me, what's the difference between like throwing animals who are intelligent beings and could also choose not to fight each other and humans and sitting around and like throwing money on it and like, ooh, I want this person to basically pummel the other person to near death and break their nose and ooh, woo, woo, woo. Like that to me is not fun. That's concerning that we as a society think that that is appropriate entertainment. I know that that's like against the traditional norms of our society and what's acceptable and what we can consider a sport, but I personally don't consider a sport. And so I struggle with it. But have I still watched boxing movies? Yes. Do I just cover my eyes because I'm not a fan of it and it grosses me out? Yes. Do I watch bloody horror movies that literally rip limbs apart and not have a problem with it? Yes. Because to me, there's some like weird divided line between the fictional aspect of horror movies that have gratuitous violence and the reality-based boxing and MMA shows and movies that to me are problematic in some way. So I'm not a big fan of them.
Wait. Horror movies are fictional, gratuitous. I lived in the same town as Jeffrey Dahmer, all right? It's a real fucking thing. Okay? Yeah.
Some of it's real. Some of it is real.
But you're not cheering it on. Like, there's not people who are throwing money on it. People are making bets with, like, real people. That would be like saying, Jeffrey Dahmer, I'll give you $20 if you go murder this man and eat his organs. Like,
they are choosing
they were saying
to do it.
They're putting $5 on which news anchor was going to throw up on the news.
And I understand that they consensually engage Aaron, but I personally think that there's... anecdotally, because of course this is not evidence based, but I personally feel like there's probably some childhood element that those consensual actions are derivative from.
Yeah, they want to win. That's a childhood. I lost all my childhood. I want to win now.
Or they feel like this is their only option to make money.
I don't think that's really the. I don't think
they're
that's,
good at it.
I don't think
do
that
it.
You're. Place to
boxing
dissect
is no
a lot of people
no
but I don't
want to
pay
football.
I don't want to pay money for
then
it.
You say you don't want to pay, but I don't think it's fair to look at them and say, well, that's they probably have something, maybe that's just something that they're really good at and they enjoy. I've known people who do box and they love it.
I understand, but to me that's the concerning part is why do we enjoy harming another individual?
Why do you like horror movies? It's no different.
Because somebody's not actually being harmed in the making of that,
but they're signing up for it.
It doesn't matter to me.
Why is the NFL the most, you know, celebrated sport and makes the most money out of anything in the world?
And also incredibly controversial and also very problematic. But we won't get into that.
Okay. So I think that watching boxing shows and movies and whatnot, they feed a certain amount of whatever it is you want to call it. If you want to call it machismo-ism or if you want to call
is
it
that a word?
I'm going to make words up as I go along, right. But if you want to call it whatever it is, you know, just the overpowering of one person over another by physical means has its attraction to the people who participate in it, has its attraction to the people who watch it. For me personally, I don't sit there and look at that stuff and go, ooh, I want to really start pummeling people, but man, do I love watching Rocky sometimes. And do I love Gladiator? There was a movie in the 90s with Cuba Gooding Jr. in it and a couple other people who I thought was a great boxing movie. It's basic, right? It's the ability of somebody to find a way to pick themselves up out of a situation that they're not happy with to create a better life with themselves by using a God-given skill. You know, it's a man over muscle or matter over mind, whatever you want to call it. All those features kind of play into why boxing movies are fun and why people watch it. Do I sit there and say, you know, it'd be a good time is let's go and watch somebody pummel the shit out of somebody else. I don't do that, but I'll watch a boxing movie because number one, it's not real. Just like I wouldn't watch somebody murder somebody else, but I'll watch a movie about it, you know?
Yeah. And the movie you were thinking of was Gladiator with,
I said Gladiator.
You said Gladiator.
Did he say the name?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, never mind then.
Tommy Riley, Cuba Gooding Jr., and the old man in it is somebody that I love. He was in Blacklist.
It was James Marshall. Brian Dennehy is a guy. Yeah.
Brian Dennehy. That's right.
Brian Dennehy.
Okay. Boxing movies are just good because of one little guy named Mac. And the fact that Mac was the thing that we were able to embody ourselves as people that maybe weren't muscular, buff football player, basketball player. We were the nerds in the theater department. But we could play as Mac, and we could go all the way through to beat Mike Tyson on a Nintendo.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Mac and me.
No.
Is this Conan O'Brien?
It's the underdog thing where it's like anybody could technically win. You land one punch in the right place, and that could literally be the difference between whether or not you win or lose. So I think that's the appeal of it, is that it's just two people duking it out. And boxing is different than MMA because boxing has very strict rules and you have to follow those rules. It's not about two people getting in the ring and pummeling themselves to death that gets a little glorified in the movies. MMA is literally go in there and kick the shit out of each other. But at least boxing is a civilized, it's like,
I wouldn't go that far.
It's the equivalent.
It's equivalent of jousting.
What do you want to call it? Not
jousting.
Kind of like, yeah, it's equivalent of jousting, you know, but now it's
fencing.
Boxing
is another one.
Fencing is another one. It's that same kind of concept. Duels. It's basically a duel. You're allowing people to punch at the same time rather than shoot at the same time. So if anything, boxing has become more civilized.
For all time, people have just enjoyed watching other people suffer at the hands of others. That's a spectator sport. Movies just make it a larger, more visual engagement. I'm not a big boxing movie. I love Sylvester Stallone. I love the first Rocky. But, you know, a lot of that is because he lost, you know. And I just thought it was more about perseverance in that movie. And it was more about dedication. And he wasn't going to quit. And he had just nothing but gumption, you know, to throw that word out there. But, you know, unfortunately, I think most boxing movies end up being about that. They don't really tell any different stories. They're all kind of the same story. Guy rises up, tries to take on the big badass who's in, you know, the heavyweight champion of the world right now or whatever. So it gets old after a while. I actually never really liked the boxing portions. I like the humanity portions. So when they do that right, it's interesting. The Rocky Balboa movie that was just called Rocky Balboa, I thought that was fantastic. I don't really care about any of the movies in between. Creed, you know, I don't really care about Creed that much. I don't really love boxing movies. I just don't. It's just... But I love when they really, you know, showcase humanity. And it's less about who's going to beat the shit out of who. It's more about where these people came from and how they're fighting to rise to the top. And I like that with any sports movie. I can watch a hockey movie like that. I hate hockey. I don't care about hockey. Don't watch soccer. Don't like soccer. But I can watch soccer movies like that. As long as you've got some underdog rising to the top, I find that interesting.
You know who does love boxing movies, though? Is the Academy. Because Rocky won 3 Academy Awards and Million Dollar Baby won 4.
Million Dollar Baby, I would say, is not really a boxing movie, though. I would argue that boxing is a factor, but it's not really a boxing movie. I mean, halfway through that movie, it becomes something different if you haven't seen
it. Would you say the same thing about Rocky, though?
No, Rocky One, I would. And Rocky Balboa, yeah. I would.
Which is why it won the Oscar, sure. Versus the other ones. Yeah.
Rocky 2, 3, 4, 5, we shouldn't even count.
Well, we don't really talk about 3 and 5.
Yeah, but those are just boxing, get rich, you know, da-da-da-da. So, yeah. And I also think boxing is a sport that's kind of faded a lot. I don't think it's nearly as appealing to the masses as it used to be. People moved on to MMA.
Came along, yeah.
MMA because they really wanted to see people get their ears bit off, and people banned that from boxing. So
yeah, really wanted to go more towards the more brutal aspect of the fight.
And Ronda Rousey, how is she still around? I mean, I saw her in a commercial. I'm like, you lost twice, humiliatingly. You're not badass anymore.
I mean, she still got to where she was. She still beat a bunch of people. She just didn't get to number one.
Well, she was number one. And then she left and came back. And then both times she got just pummeled.
Yeah.
In like the first minute.
So she's not like, she's still not irrelevant.
I didn't say she was irrelevant. I'm just saying you should probably hide a little longer. That was embarrassing. Those were embarrassing fights. I was rooting for her on those too. I'm like, so I might be out $5 and I'm really mad about it. Damn it. I also want to mention before we move on, Did you guys hear DeSantis signed it into law that Disney no longer officially controls Reedy Creek?
No.
So, yeah. So it's official. It's in a law. Disney, for people that don't know, Disney World, which is housed in Orlando, all that surrounding area, Disney has controlled for decades because they had a deal where they could control all the infrastructure and everything else to make everything run smooth.
And police, fire, water, sewage. Yep. It literally was its own
city.
Kind of like DC.
Yeah, very much. And then, which is really ironic because this is a true freedom of speech violation, but whatever. We don't want to get into the politics. The governor, DeSantis, did not like that Disney came out against a policy that he had. And he just said, you know, we're going to take that away. Not going to have that anymore. Mm-hmm. And now they don't have it anymore. So the big corporations can be beaten now and again. That's a big deal for Disney. That's huge.
I just wonder if they're going to relocate elsewhere then. Because they had so much autonomy. Ooh. They probably had revenue that came from some of that as well. And now they're going to be down all of that. And it's kind of like them against the government of the state. Disney has enough money. They could do it.
They have billions invested in that. It would cost them billions to even think about moving.
But if they could get somewhere else where they could garner some of that money back, because I guarantee you they lost money by having this happen.
I don't see how that's feasible. John, you're,
it's not,
you're in Florida. What do you think?
Yeah.
What can Disney do? It'd be, on a hypothetical side, would it be interesting if they just picked up sticks and left? Sure. But there's absolutely no way they can do that because if you look at the amount of land that Disney controls, they just can't shut down the park and pick it up and move it. It's just not going to happen.
But they just lost bunch of that control.
Well, no, they still own a lot of land.
They just can't control any of it.
That's what I just said. They lost a lot of control.
They basically got to pay taxes.
Right. They still own a lot of the land theirs. They just just lost control of some of the infrastructure. That's fine. They'll figure out a way. It'll still probably make money hand over fist. But do I like the idea of maybe it picking up sticks? Absolutely not, because I don't pay state taxes and because of Disney, and I would rather not ever pay state taxes. So
John's like, this one, Disney. This was on you.
Yeah.
It's on you. You should have done it.
Yeah, you shouldn't have said anything, or you know what, maybe spend some of that money to get some people out of office. How's that?
No, I think they should. I have no problem with them speaking out, but that's a freedom of speech thing. That is, everybody that touts about freedom of speech left and right, that is literally a violation of freedom of speech. Go look it up. It just drives me nuts, but whatever, it's done.
Right.
I wonder if they're going to
sue. You
got to
remember, this is really no different than, take Chicago, for example, Allstate. Insurance companies here based in Northbrook, Illinois, outside of Chicago, they had a great tax break and they have a huge campus. I mean, it is literally like probably one exit to another exit as you're driving down the interstate. They're gone. They moved out of Illinois after all these years and went to South Carolina because taxes. So when they lost their tax deal and they didn't have all the tax breaks that they were getting from Illinois, they moved to somewhere where it was cheaper. So Disney makes money hand over fist. They could absolutely pick up that whole park and move it somewhere
else. No, they couldn't.
Yes, they could.
There's miles.
They absolutely could.
I do not see how that's possible.
They could sell the whole thing to a bunch of greedy ass developers who want to build condos. They'd make bank on it, and it would be like, it basically would pay for the rebuild.
5 years.
Else.
That's minimum 5 years. I read an article that said that research, if they were to strip it and move on, it would take like 5 years to rebuild that park the way that it is now.
Yeah, it's no different than building a new football stadium. It takes 5 years.
That's a big difference from a football stadium, roller coasters, theme park, all that stuff. That's so much more infrastructure. And
dude, you could take a roller coaster down at Six Flags at one park and move it to another park in the winter and stand it back up and it'd be ready for the next summer.
I do not want to ride that roller coaster. I do not want to ride that. I will take the 6 month later ride. You take the first one. I want you to test it.
No one said you had to be there on opening day. But they can do it.
It's going
to
be 6 months later. How long has it been since the roller coaster is shot off the rails?
You just go there on opening day and there's cars all over the parking lot. That's not cool. Well, we moved it. You never know, I guess. And Amanda, I think you're asking if they would sue. Maybe.
Yeah, I'm saying I wonder if they will.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, that's
I would if I was Disney.
Yeah, that's probably the most likely outcome, is that Disney turns around and sues. But I'm still picturing a Space Mountain that actually launches you through
the building. Into outer space.
They can just wait. Honestly, they could probably just wait it out to fight it until DeSantis, it's predicted that he's, when he has his presidential run. That's really their most opportune time to fight it then.
Yeah, I feel like they would try to back a candidate that would reinstate it, probably. I'm sure we'll hear about this again.
And again, this isn't a DeSantis thing. This is, people forget how laws are made. It has to go to the Senate and the House.
He started it. Come on. He's been...
Well, of course he started it.
Yeah.
And it's a completely red-controlled state. So it's going to get passed. But if you can figure out, like, get enough people in at the next election, which is right around the corner...
Right.
It could be overturned just as quickly.
Right. All right.
But it's not just Ron that did it.
Troy's
Wait,
like,
how did I get pulled into this? No,
Troy's like,
I didn't say John.
He said Ron. Troy's just trying to stop any forward momentum, I think, is what's happening here. But we'll see.
I mean, unless the J is silent in your name now, then I was talking about you.
Ooh. You know, usually the R is silent, but yeah.
Hey, our show is independently funded, and therefore all the expenses are from our own pockets, and Patreon helps fans support their favorite podcast. You can sign up to patreon.com/thehollywoodoutsider. That's Patreon, patreon.com/thehollywoodoutsider. Sign up right now. You get immediate access to all kinds of content. We just had a new bad movie night for the faculty that's on there. And again, there is a public bad movie night, but that is for older episodes. New, unedited episodes are always exclusive for a long time on our Patreon. And also, John is doing a half-hour power hour, is what he calls his program, which is exclusive solely to Patreon. Right now, he's covering The Last of Us, and after that show is over, you know, episode by episode, he's doing it right now. After that show's over, he's got a new format where he's going to look at specific episodes of television that people love and kind of look at why people love them. So get subscribed. He's getting ready to start that soon, so get subscribed. Patreon.com/TheHollywoodOutsider. Now let's go to our spoiler-free reviews. We've got two. Let's start with Cocaine Bear. You ready, Amanda?
I'm as ready as I can ever be.
You and I saw Cocaine Bear. We opened in 1985, and Andrew Thornton is kicking kilos of cocaine out of his plane as he heads for an inevitable crash. The idea being that this way, at least they can recover the coke and salvage the operation after the fact. Well, things simply don't go as planned, and the next thing we know, there are tons of cocaine packages wasting away in a vast Georgia forest. Drug runners Eddie and David, led by Ray Liotta's delightfully savage Sid in the actor's final performance, hit the woods in search of the drugs, and unbeknownst to everyone, a mischievous black bear has found the stash, and she is ready to party while dancing in the blood of innocence. We also have Sari, that's played by Carrie Russell. She's a mom on the hunt for her truant daughter and her daughter's friend who skipped school for a wilderness adventure, including trying to find cocaine and try it. That's true. Kids tried cocaine. Possibly. Bob, who's Isaiah Whitlock Jr. He's a cop searching for the cocaine with a desperate need for animal companionship. He's really, really desperate for a puppy. And Ranger Liz, Margot Martindale. You know Margot. She's great. The Americans Justify. Great actress. She's a ranger with her sights set on love. More so than saving the town from a coked out raging fur beast. So, all right, Amanda, it's all in the title. Cocaine Bear. The script. Let's use that term
the
loosely.
The script? I was going to say what script.
Let's say the script. How did you, do you feel like this captured what you wanted to see from a movie called Cocaine Bear?
There were moments where it did, but to be perfectly honest, I wanted a little less script. I wanted more absurdities for the cocaine bear. I wanted to see more of just like bonkers concepts of what a bear would do on cocaine or what a bear would do to get more cocaine. And we got a lot of that, but it felt more of the background of the story rather than being the foreground, because we focused so much on all of these other characters that every single character, which there's like three separate groups of individuals that we're focusing on, if not more, that we get like backstory for them. We get their current, like where they're at now, and we get a development in their story, which is, you know, that's great and everything, but I just don't give a shit. I just want to see the bear doing ridiculous things on cocaine. That's what I'm coming for. That's what my money's for. So
you want to spend all time with Sharknado. You don't want to see all the people that are looking up.
Maybe
the
a little less Sharknado, you know, but I wanted the bear to still be the primary focal point of this film. And it felt like that wasn't necessarily the direction that they took.
Oh, well, I feel like the movie, because we both saw it, I really, really love, I didn't love it, but I liked it a lot. Mm-hmm. I thought it was great. I do think it takes a little bit to get going. The opening really starts with where the bear is and all this, and then it just goes to characters for a good 20 minutes before the bear is really back, maybe 30. And it's not really that long a movie, but I kind of just want the bear coked out of its mind the whole movie. I mean, I get that. On the same token, you got to make it a movie. You got to make it more than just, otherwise I think people would just be exhausted with a one note joke of a movie. So you gotta have some care. And I think there's some character growth. I don't know about that, but there's some character shenanigans going on. I like the tone. I thought the script really did a good job of balancing the tone, making it a little wacky, a little nostalgic because it takes place in 85, mm-hmm. while also just being nuts. So to me, it worked, but I do agree it took a little to get going. Oh, well, I'm just glad I saw a movie called Cocaine Bear. Any actors stand out for you?
I wouldn't say that anyone necessarily stood out to me. One surprised me because it felt like a David Spade ripoff, was hilarious. It's the fella from Modern Family, actually, if you're a fan of the show, Jesse Tyler Ferguson. But regardless, he comes across so hippie-like, but also just ridiculous and hilarious. I think he was probably the most significant cast member, other than Margot that you mentioned already, that came out of the film that I was like, oh, I really, really liked him. And could not, you know, honestly, I didn't even recognize him at first. I really was like, who is this David Spade ripoff?
Ever. Worst wig ever.
It's not great.
I like Scott Sice. He's a TikTok guy. He actually has like a bit part here where he's a paramedic and he shows up to help Ranger Liz, and the bear is in the area. And there's just like this whole set piece, which is a fantastic set piece with an ambulance and a chase and everything else. And he was just hysterical. And if you don't know what the TikTok guy I'm talking about, he's a guy that does all the TikTok videos where he's talking about working in a store and all the things he's not going to do as an employee. It's pretty funny. Scott Sice, look him
he
up.
He had a really funny TikTok about the movie coming out that you should definitely check out. Yeah. The other one that I would say that I really enjoyed is Christian Convery, who is the child actor. He was also in Sweet Tooth, if you saw Sweet Tooth, but he played Henry in this film. And there was a lot of, I don't know, comedic elements to his character and to his performance that I really enjoyed, but also retained the youthfulness and felt like a kid who's actually in these scenarios. And that part I really adored.
Yeah, Alden Ehrenreich, who was Han Solo in the Solo movie, mm-hmm. Looks like he's had a rough run since Solo because he looks about 40 years older in this.
Leave him be.
I'm just saying, I feel like he's very mad about the whole Disney thing. He's like, I'm no longer Disney. Now I'm in a movie called Cocaine Bear. This sucks. But yeah, nobody really said Ray Liotta, his final performance. I kind of like that. He went just bonkers. He just really, really let loose and had a lot of fun. But overall, and also I should say, did you find it gory? Cause the violence is really just visceral.
My standards of gore are probably much different than most people's. So was I like, whoa, this is too much? Absolutely not. It was probably the right amount of gore. There were definitely some pretty impactful, pun there, scenes where the violence comes across. But there were moments where it's like the bear does something and I'm like, if the bear actually did this to a person, the person would not be breathing. The person would have every bone in their body crushed.
Most of the people are. There aren't many people walking around after that.
I'm not going to spoil, but there's two moments in particular where I'm like, this is absolutely like outrageously inaccurate. It's how did we get here?
It's a movie called Cocaine Bear. I don't want to hear anyone talk about inaccuracy. It's a movie about a cocaine.
But it doesn't line up with how they.
It's a cocaine.
It doesn't matter.
Murder bear. I don't understand. Matter. Yeah, it does.
No,
it does.
They're like 600 pounds, man.
I'm just saying, if you're gonna make a movie called Cocaine Bear, you just got to accept that shit's gonna get crazy.
They care. They manage the logistics in some areas guess of how
what?
This would work.
Guess you what? Bears can smell a lot, but they're not gonna be tripping balls and then hunting people down just because they smell like cocaine either. But they do in this movie because it's funny. Simple as that.
I have a question, which is, does the movie ever drop in any lines that this is a true story?
Yes.
It's inspired by a true story, John. The true story is actually kind of sad, but.
Well, close enough.
Mm-hmm.
But not in the film. I think
Sour Patch Watermelon in the real life.
It's not in the film, though. I think it's more just like this was inspired by a true story, inspired by true events.
Yeah, it says inspired by true events. Yeah.
And that's, but they don't like reference anything in the film, if that's what you're asking.
They show live news footage. Tom Brokaw's on here, like when the real thing happened. And he's like, hey, there's a bear like ravaged by cocaine right now. What's up, guys? That's messed up. All right. If $10 full price admission, what do you give Cocaine Bear?
I'm giving it $5.50.
Wow. You hate fun, huh?
All right. Don't hate it. I just wanted more fun.
It was lots of fun. I gave it $7. I had a great time. Great time. One more movie that is coming out to theaters March 3rd and expanding to Shudder on March 21st is Children of the Corn. And it's also going to be available on digital and demand on March 21st. And this is a prequel to the Stephen King story, Children of the Corn. So basically it's explaining what happened to the town that you find in the cornfield. And it goes a few different directions than you would think. Possessed by a spirit in a dying cornfield, a 12-year-old girl in Nebraska recruits the other children in her small town to go on a bloody rampage and kill all the adults and anyone else who opposes her. A bright high schooler who won't go along with the plan is the town's only hope for survival. It's based on that short story, Children of the Corn, by Stephen King. And it's directed and written by Kurt Wimmer, who famously did Ultraviolet and Equilibrium. It's starring Elena Comporis, Kate Moyer, Callan Mulvey, and Bruce Spence. So, Children of the Corn, I really like the story. The original movie in the 80s, I was a fan of it. It was kind of a cool idea. Two people wander into a town, all the adults are gone, and the kids are running the town. Hey, crazy world. Well, here we're kind of explaining what happens with these kids and how they take over this town. And man, there's some moments in the movie where I think, wow, that's really good. I like that. I feel like Kate Moyer, who plays Eden, she's kind of the young girl corralling all the kids. And then Elena Comporis is Boland. She's the teenager who's fighting against it. I really liked Kate Moyer's Eden. I mean, she's a young girl. She's 12, but she's really doing a good job of just being kind of a mustache twirling villain. I mean, I think she's fun to watch. She's always kind of snide, right on the other side of bratty, but usually interesting. The problem with the movie is, man, not much of it makes sense. How they take over the town is pretty ludicrous. It feels like the adults never really put up any kind of a fight, and it's pretty easy to overpower a bunch of kids, you would think, but they don't even try. And I mean, it just goes from 1 minute to the next minute, and bam, they've got the whole town. Now, don't get me wrong, Children of the Corn had the concept that they took over the town, and we don't even, you know, get to see what happened. But in the same token, it's one thing to not see it. I think not seeing it actually makes it more effective, because when you see it happening, you're just like, huh, how did that happen? Why didn't you guys deserve to be caught and killed if this is what happens, because it makes no sense. I mean, adults are typically at least twice as much in weight as the kids, and they're moving these adults around like crazy. They are having no problem corralling them, getting them to do their bidding. There's really not much of a fight in these adults. You know, it makes it hard to really believe a lot of it. And then as the movie goes on, there's a corn monster. That's all I can say. There's a corn monster. I wanted to like this movie more than I did. I do enjoy the director. I think he has some vision of what he wants Children of the Corn to be and kind of expanding it a little bit to be more than it was, it just doesn't work ultimately. So if $10 is full price of admission, I give it $4. I mean, it's not a horrible watch, but as it goes on and the adults really start taking on the brute force of the kids, it becomes less able for me to enjoy it because it just becomes kind of nonsense. So, you know, if it's on Shudder, I don't check it out, but I wouldn't recommend paying money in a theater for it. All right, let's move on to our From the Outside In topic. Man versus nature? Question mark. We've talked about beasts and predators in entertainment. We talked about that last year when Beast came out. But let's face it, it's those animals or insects we regularly come in contact with that really seem to scare us. So we're going to start off by acknowledging Jaws is the bestest. It's the bestest, the best, scariest real life thing out there, whatever. But we don't really run into sharks ever. So it's not exactly the most likely scenario. So let's talk about animals, insects, whatever, bees, snakes on planes, wolves, spiders, bears on cocaine, whatever. Why are people so afraid of nature? Let's discuss. John?
Well, to me, it's that uncontrollable, unknown thing. You know, a man has their limitations, and the limitations that some of these animals may have just really boils down to how quickly they can shove you in their face and digest you. And the thing is that there's aspects of that are just truly scary. I just remember over the weekend when I was doing a filming project, and we were just happened to talk about freshwater fishing versus saltwater fishing. And one of the people there that I was filming with turns around and says, "Hey, I'm only 100% saltwater these days because I can punch a shark. But if an alligator comes rolling up on me, I might poop myself." And I couldn't argue that fact. alligators are scary, monstrous, and yeah, those things are not fun to see in real life. And I have one living behind my place right now. So I don't know. There's a lot to it. Yeah.
Oh, we should go out and try to pet it to see what happens.
I got pictures of it if you want to see it, but that's not going to do the podcast any good.
I know someone who is planning to retire to South Carolina, and the one thing they told me that they're really looking forward to, and mind you, they're in like a remote area, is building a little water area in the backyard so they can have alligators. They're going to get pet alligators for their backyard as part of the retirement plan.
No, 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 no.
Some people like to live dangerously, John.
No, that's not dangerously. That's just stupid. Okay. There's a lot of things that I feel like are cute and cuddly. I think a lion can be cute and cuddly. Mm-hmm. I think a bear, cute and cuddly. I think just a grizzly bear, even a polar bear, I'll even try to cuddle a polar bear. I know it's going to probably destroy me, but I'll try it once because that's all the only chance I'm going to ever get. But I will never, ever, ever try to cuddle an alligator. That's just not, no.
They're also spiky and bumpy. I mean, are you trying to spoon the alligator? Like, that doesn't sound comfortable at all.
Yeah, no.
Don't judge what he likes. Maybe he likes it spiky.
I mean, there's plenty of them around down there. I'm just saying.
I know. I have one in my backyard.
Do you feed it?
Back on topic. Back on topic, kids.
Come
on.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My thing about it is I think people really are terrified of them because you can't control them. And people are afraid of things they can't control. You know, that's why people are afraid of their spouses.
I also think there's the level, the element that you hear horrifying stories about these nature incidents. And in a lot of ways, it's your inability to be able to, like, defend yourself. Like, if you have a swarm of bees who are coming to attack you, what are you really going to do unless you have, like, a I don't know, some sort of fire device? What are those little torch sprayer things that go
Flamethrower.
Unless you have one.
Or a torch, maybe.
Unless you have one sitting like in your car, in your or in your back pocket, like you're screwed. You don't have anything. If a wolf or a bear comes to attack you, you're screwed. There's nothing you can do about it. So I think it's...
You can fight off a wolf. Bear is a bigger problem.
I don't think I'm going to fight off a wolf. Today has been my day.
It's the friends of the wolf they got to worry about.
If Liam Neeson has taught me anything, you can fight a wolf.
You can fight a wolf. Yeah.
It's the inability to control that, to feel like you have any control to defend yourself, to defend the people that you care about. And because you hear these horror stories about things that have occurred in the past, you think that isolated incident could happen to me. So I don't want to have that risk because the risk is that much greater. It's different than if a chihuahua attacks you, right? If a chihuahua attacks you, it's annoying and it's going to suck, right? But you're going to survive.
But people are scared about it without stories. People are just naturally inclined to be petrified of insects. Why? Insects, 9 times out of 10, can do nothing to you. Maybe a disease, but that's the one out of 10.
It's a lack of control, though.
Yeah, it's totally just a lack of, I'm not in charge of this thing, and it came out of nowhere, and it's on my skin, and I'm not sure I can get it in time. Yeah, it can violate you.
Mm-hmm. And it probably will.
Mm-hmm.
I had a wasp that bit me, and it tried to go in a place it shouldn't have gone.
Whoa.
What were you doing with the...
Mowing the lawn, and I stepped forward.
Were you naked? Where was this thing?
No, I was wearing shorts. It's hot. I was wearing some higher shorts, and it got between my thighs in the middle.
Everybody saw that movie. So.
All right. So wait a minute. Hold on a second.
So much for sundress season.
Right.
Yeah. So there's much for that. Sundress season.
So let me make sure I understand this correctly. You're mowing the lawn in super short shorts.
It's 95 degrees. Yeah.
And a wasp.
Yes.
Goes for your hoo-ha.
It did not get there, but I feel like it sure tried because it got awful close. It got
and
awfully close.
Bring flowers.
Okay.
I just appreciate that John had to explain it. Like it went somewhere that it wasn't supposed to go. Wasn't enough. You had to explicitly tell it to everybody.
I'm just trying to figure out the thinking here because I've mowed lawns in 90 degree weather plus. You know what I've never done?
Do you wear short booty shorts? Do you wear short booty shorts?
I've never worn short booty shorts. Like,
you're missing out, I guess.
Patreon.
Right.
If you want to see John in short booty shorts.
That's extra. I might have taken off a shirt, but never in like my front lawn. My back lawn, I probably took off a shirt just to be like, hey, why don't I get some of this white taken care of?
I got it. Party in the back. I got it.
Right. Yeah, party in the back. But I've never... Not once ever have I thought, you know what would be really good idea right now is that it's so hot, I'm going to wear shorts that cut up inside of me so that
up inside me.
I think you're making too much of the shorts, man. Let's focus on the wasp that's going for the hoo-ha.
Look, I'm with Amanda. Like, I was on my bike pedaling at 22 miles an hour.
I've seen your bike
and
shorts.
And one of those bastards just literally... flew out of nowhere and smacked me right in the side of the neck.
Did it terrify you?
I'm going 20. I literally almost fell off my bike because I was like, holy blah, 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 blah. Like I didn't know what it was. I thought it got hit by a blow dart or something.
He's like, there's a Russian spy trying to take me out.
Troy down.
Get the van.
Yeah, all of a sudden, like SWAT team swarms in and they scoop him up. They grab his bicycle.
It was like a frontage road next to the highway. I don't know if it was like a rock or something that got kicked up from a car. It was like, what the hell?
I'd be terrified of wasps too. Jesus.
Sounded brutal.
I didn't know the Russians were using them.
I didn't know the Russians were using them.
Look, I'm definitely afraid of ants now, thanks to The Last of Us. So, I'm never stepping on an ant ever again because I don't want to piss him off, and then like his mom's affected with cordyceps and comes attacks me. The Last of Us is the cordyceps infection, and technically cordyceps does actually infect ants today.
Right, right.
So you piss off one ant, and that whole colony's coming after you to turn you into a fungus monster.
You ever seen, I actually saw a video, or somebody shared it in our Facebook group, I'm sorry, I forget who did it, I apologize, I think it was Jason West, but showing an ant colony that built a bridge to get to a wasp nest to take it over, so the ants basically just went, did you see that too?
It's a Bug's Life, man. If you didn't watch A Bug's Life, then you don't understand how capable ants are.
It's a cartoon.
Doesn't matter. They're capable. But and they tried to tell us in the 90s.
It's not a cartoon. The humans in the Pixar theory were wiped out, and the bugs in Bug's Life are after the humans are already gone. So you should definitely be afraid of ants in the Bug's Life because we already lost per the Pixar theory.
So we agree. We're just afraid of things we can't control. Ultimately, that's what it boils down.
Yes, that's what that's. I mean, back to the topic at hand before we lose it again. Yes, that's exactly what we're all saying.
Now, what are you guys? Are you more afraid of the things that are like buzzing around your head, insects like that, or things that come out of nowhere, or a little creepy crawly like mice and that sort of thing? Or are you more afraid of the big, menacing beasts that can come at you,
no.
like bears?
No, it's ticks. Ticks are the most horrifying thing because
I
was literally outside. Playing in a nice open grassy soccer field, and I reached up behind my ear and I felt something and I was just like, ah, and I like ripped it out. You're not supposed to do that, but I was just like freaking out because I was like,
you got
eight.
24 hours, you can rip it out. When we went, it's like,
wait,
back,
you're not supposed to rip it out?
No, because the head stays inside.
The head can't, not always. Here's a true story. You want to hear a cool, or horrible tick story? This is true. So I go backpacking all the time, right? Couple times a year, and I go with my friends. And my buddy Joe comes, and he's a big dude. Whatever reason, ticks love him. Like, he has tick cologne. He is a tick whore. They come around, and they're like, yeah, baby, that's where that meat is. And they just, like, wherever we are, if there are ticks, they are drawn to him. It's insane. And so we go to this one spot that we were camping at, and every time he turned around, he had a tick on him. And now he's the opposite of me. You know, he's tough. So he's like, every time he's got a tick on him, he's pulling it off. And he puts it in a Ziploc bag. So he's putting them all in a Ziploc bag. And after a day.
How many has he accumulated?
Hang on. After one day, he had, I think it was like 30 ticks in this bag.
No shit.
Yeah. And we finally decided.
What the hell?
Oh, man, it was a bad spot. So we said, you know what? We're out of here. We're done. I had like two. I had two. He had like 25 or something. No. This bag was almost full. Mm-mm. Couldn't even sleep. I mean, which understandable. So we came out and we had a fire and he, you know.
Burned them all.
Yeah.
On his body?
As for sacrifice to teach every other tick. His idea was I'm going to teach.
Viking funeral?
Yep, exactly. I'm going to teach all the other ticks a lesson so they know don't come out here and fuck with me again. And yeah.
So he had a bunch of tick heads just left in his body all over?
No, the thing is, they have to be in there for like 24 hours because it has to ingest into your body. If they were,
your body consumes
They suck. They suck out your blood, and while they're doing that, their venom or whatever is getting into you.
I have a new fear. You've literally just unlocked a new fear for me.
Well, you should always, when you're in the woods, you always check yourself for ticks. Always.
Yeah.
That's why I don't
especially
go
your
to the woods.
Because it's an attractive place, apparently.
Yeah, ticks are everywhere. Yeah, no,
mm-mm.
They are. That's why.
No, I'm saying
that's
the I
best,
don't want this.
That is the best part about the only good part about the Midwest is they actually get killed off in the winter, where in the South they never die. They just keep breeding, and they eventually grow into crocodiles. Little known fact.
Yep, or scorpions.
Right,
scorpions are all over Arizona.
There you go. They just become other horrible creatures.
I'm truly terrified to exist now.
Good. There's a movie called Ticks. Go watch it.
No, thank you. I think
it's also called Arachnophobia. Spiders are awful.
Oh, Arachnophobia is such a good movie.
Even Eight-Legged Freaks fucks me up. I'm sorry. Messes me up, you guys.
That's
scary. That's a great movie, too.
It's not that it's scary. It's the concept. Like, my head.
The concept of David Arquette got a leading role.
Leave him alone. I like him. Fair. But no, he was. Yeah, that's fair. But no, it's the concept like in my head that there's, you know, could you imagine? And so my brain does start to imagine if there were spiders that big and like they could right now. Everybody tells you, oh, it's not that big. It's just a little spider. Okay, bitch, what if it was the size of, like, your architectural buildings in a large city of Chicago? Then what are you going to do?
Well, I don't
Then are you going to tell me I'm a pansy? No, you're going to cry.
I don't think they're going to tell you anything because you started that conversation off with calling them a bitch for no reason other than they were just trying to have discourse.
My head goes too wild in spirals. And so that movie really freaked me out. And it was also the timing of it. I think I watched that movie maybe a month after I found out from my fifth grade teacher, Mr. Johnson. Thank you, sir, for giving me nightmares, fuel inducing nightmares for decades, that you eat spiders when you sleep because they crawl into your mouth and your open holes of things. So now I'm scared. What? Like your ears and your nose, guys.
Okay.
Your mouth.
All right, everybody. Thank you very much for being here tonight. It's time to go home.
I guess it depends how you sleep, right?
I never wanted to be the jelly monster, the jelly guy from Ant-Man Quantumanium that doesn't have any holes.
Yeah. Like
that guy's
no
got
holes.
It right.
No holes. It's weird because I sleep ass up. I don't know what that means.
Your balls just puckered, ready to go. Oh my god. Anyway, so yes, that terrified me, and I watched that movie shortly after.
What is
after.
Happening tonight? Jesus. I don't know.
What's your most horrific experience with nature, both as a film goer and in real life? Both.
Right now, it's your butthole being puckered.
Troy.
His other side is all swollen up from the wasp sting.
Oh my gosh.
I have to say it was the tick experience. I think that's the most horrifying, like not knowing what it was and just like freaking out because I'm like, get it out. That had to have been the most horrifying experience. I mean, you've been stung by bees. You've been bit by stuff. It's like, I even got bit by a snake once. Wasn't a big deal. I would say the tick was probably the biggest one.
And movie?
Oh gosh. Arachnophobia for sure.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah. I mean, I think it was compounded because like after arachnophobia, I was like on a spider killing spree. And one time
poor innocent spiders died because of that movie.
Spiders were
I stepped on a spider once and it had babies. And then when I stepped on it, like millions of little baby spiders. I was like, ah.
Amanda literally took her headphones off so she didn't have to hear your story.
No. Nope.
So if you could repeat it.
I'll take them right back off.
I understand that whole concept, like when people jump up on the table when they like see a mouse or something. That's what it was like when the baby spiders came up.
I literally have chills and like goosebumps all over my body. It's horrible.
All right, I'll share mine. So I was stung over 120 times.
Is this the bee story again?
It's the bee story. Aaron Bee story.
Well, hey, I'll tell you that. I was stung over 120 times over the course of 2 summers, all right? But bees. I hate bees. I petrified. I will literally abandon babies and anything else I can if a bee is around. I will not. Yeah. I am not a hero.
And that's a true story.
Hot tip, Aaron. Don't mow your grass anymore.
I won't. Especially, I definitely don't do it in booty shorts. Don't do it in booty shorts. But I will tell you another story because this one people haven't heard, but it was terrifying. It didn't happen to me, but I was there when it happened. And after I got done laughing, I felt really scared. So I had mice in my house at one point, right? Mm-mm. And Deadly Eyes is a movie that freaks me out. It's about rodents that take over New York, giant rodents. But I had mice in my house, and I was trying to get rid of them. My buddy Dennis comes over to help me, right? He's like, I'll help you take care of them. And we find out, like, under the deck, when they built the house, they didn't frame it correctly. So it wasn't sealed. It wasn't sealed underneath. So he's like, well, I can get under there because I'm incapable. At that time I was. Now I can fix stuff, but I couldn't at that time. So he gets under he's got to remove the old board and put on a new board and seal it. He takes the board off. Mice and shit fall all over him. All over him. Yeah, you're right, listener. Don't hit the guardrail. It was both hilarious and terrifying. And I thought he was going to just like really not talk to me after
I wouldn't.
That.
You know, you're fired as a friend.
Absolutely.
That's somebody who really loves you.
Yeah.
Like the fact that he went through trauma for you.
He did. He's a hero. In terms of movies.
Not only did he go through trauma, but you laughed at him.
Tell me, somebody's covered in mice and shit. It's a little funny. After you know they're okay.
Okay, after you know they're okay. Yeah, if the customary, oh crap, are you okay? You are?
This might also explain why when we were at the cabin at Rock Cut and we had the mouse in the cabin, that you were outside, but we were the ones that were in there trying to get rid of it.
Yep, not a fan. It freaks me out at this point. Bees. I'm literally terrified of bees, but I'm very phobic. I definitely have a phobia. In terms of movies, The Giant Ants and Them, I've talked about that before. That really stuck with me. But I will tell you, the roaches in Creepshow, that I have a hard time watching that because it scares the crap out of me. Like, how many roaches are just all over that? Cockroaches freak me out. Because you don't know they're there until you know they're there. And then once you know they're there, you know they're everywhere. All right, John, what you got?
Oh my God, I have so many real life stories of encounters with. I'm trying to figure out which ones are the best ones. I mean, there's that time that I was hunting grasshoppers and I was underneath this bush. And there was the grasshopper incident. And then there was a time I was playing hide and go seek and I was underneath the same bush. So it happened to me twice now, or not now, but then, where I was just chilling and I was just doing my own thing. And all of a sudden I look, you know, something makes me look up in the bush and inches away from my face is a snake's head. And it's just like doing that whole thing at me. And it freaked me the F out. Let's see. More snake story. I go in my backyard. This is all in Panama. I go in my backyard and, you know, we're all hanging out in the backyard. I'm sitting by the ditch that goes through our backyard. And I'm just chilling. And, you know, we're all kind of like joking around as little kids and telling stories and whatnot. And all of a sudden, this log that I was sitting on starts to freaking move.
What?
You were sitting on a snake?
It was a giant boa, and it was freaking huge.
Was it trying to wrap around you and say, hey.
No, it wasn't trying to wrap around me or anything, but I was sitting on it, and it didn't do anything, and I didn't even realize that it was a boa. That I thought I was literally sitting on a branch or something, and it just decides after me sitting on it for a while that it's tired of me sitting on it, and it's time to go, and it just takes me with it for a little while, and I just, like, jumped up and ran off because there's that. Let's see. More snake stories.
Oh my God. So don't go to Panama.
You would think with all the different, my problem is alligators. You'd think I'd have a problem with snakes. I'm not a big fan of them, but, this one didn't happen to me. This happened to my brother though. It was the 80s. So my parents, at the time my brother was maybe 11 or 12, and he is technically the adult in the house as my parents go out for the night. And, if he was 11 or 12, that means I was 7 or 6, and my sister was, I don't know, flinging shit around. Who knows? And my parents come home and my brother has his room to himself and they flip on the light to his room to see how he's doing. And he's in bed, but they realize that they can see some movement over the lamp that's directly over his head of his, you know, while he's lying in bed. And what it is so in Panama, they have these snakes called fertilances and they're highly venomous snakes. And it is wrapped itself around the chain to the lamp that's right over my brother's head. And it is going down the chain towards my brother. So my dad gets on the phone and calls the guardia. They come to the house. And my mother goes to save my brother because this is how backwards shit was in my house. And so she yanks him out of the bed before the snake can get anywhere near him. So, and then a couple minutes later is when the guardia show up to take care of the snake for us. So the guardia showed up and the guardia had an MP with him. Cause at the time MPs sometimes would travel around with the guardia. And, the MP is like, oh my God, I have to call this in. So he goes to call his supervisor and the guardia is sitting there looking at the snake. The snake's sitting there looking at the guardia and the two of them lock eyes. And that's when the guardia pulls out his stick and thumps it on the head. And like the snake just kind of wobbles and then goes completely limp. Picks it up. He looks at my mom. He goes, you got something I can put this in? And my mom hands him a tin that we used to have for peanuts and he would put the snake in there. And we were like, what are you going to do with him? He goes, dinner tomorrow night.
Well, you got to eat.
Yeah.
You know what never scares me? Snakes. And I'm a big I'm a big man, baby, for a lot of things. Bees, mice, whatever. But no, snakes, for whatever reason, don't do anything for me. I used to play with them when we lived by a field. We'd go in the field and we'd just play with them.
Yes, like there's something about snakes that inside of me, if I see a snake inside of me, there's like a moment of where I freeze. It's one of the few times where I feel that freeze that happens to you whenever you see something. That snakes are the only thing. Yeah, for a few seconds, and then I can do stuff. Other things that scare me, I go from oh shit, it's gonna hurt me to I'm gone, and I'm probably tripping you while I'm running so that you can get eaten, and I'm just gonna go.
What about movies or movie? What movie scared you the most?
You know, I've been trying to find this movie, but there's a movie about it was about ants, and it wasn't giant ants; it was just normal small ants, and they were. I've been trying to find the movie itself, but I've been having so much trouble getting a handle on it. Maybe it was Phase 4,
Empire of the Ants,
I think maybe Empire of the Ants, but that one, for whatever the reason was, because I know what the reason was, because I grew up again in a country which stuff like this would you would see these long trails of ants going from one place to another. They're usually cutting down trees and, you know, all sorts of stuff. But the idea of there being so many ants that it was inescapable. Not Empire of the Ants. Empire of the Ants is giant ants.
I don't think Empire of the Ants was.
No, I'm looking at it right now.
Okay. Could be wrong, I guess.
Yeah, Empire of the Ants. Yeah, that's giant ants. So I'm thinking it's either ants or it's Phase 4. But anyhow, the having so many small creatures that are inescapable, and as far as a movie is concerned, that freaks me out.
Amanda?
Well, I kind of shared my movie reference already.
Which was?
Eight-Legged Freaks.
Oh, Eight-Legged Freaks, right.
I've arachnophobia is one. I have that. So I'm not going to watch a movie of that has the phobia name that I also have. I'm good.
It's kind of funny.
To me, that's a good sign to say don't
Why
watch
Why am I
this.
So scared? I thought this would be a comedy. This ain't funny.
My life examples, they're endless. They're endless. So other than Mr. Johnson destroying my entire life, let me also tell you about the time that I walked out. I was probably, 9 or 10 years old, already traumatized because bugs exist. And there's just too many instances that I can recall. I walk out of the shower. I never get ready in the bathroom. I always have to get ready in my room. Like, I want the steam to go away. I don't want to get ready in steam. So I'm walking out of the bathroom. I have a towel wrapped around me. All of a sudden, I feel something on the top of my foot. And I'm like, I kind of like shake it off or whatever thing. And maybe it's like a drop of water. I look down because I still felt it a second later. And there's a big ass spider that fell from the attic door onto my foot.
Oh, you just want a free ride.
Yeah.
It's traumatized like you're an Uber. You're a spider Uber.
Spider Uber. Are you guys scared of centipedes? How about centipedes?
No.
Too many legs, too much fuzziness.
I always admire them because they have so many legs and they go so damn slow.
Centipedes are also butterflies.
Caterpillars.
That's caterpillars.
Yeah. Wrong one. Wrong book.
Wrong one. Whatever.
Wrong book.
They all have lots of legs.
Hey, you know, I want to interject something right now. Can we all just agree that Mr. Johnson destroying my entire life is a title of a different kind of movie?
No. But once again, you made it weird.
Oh my gosh. It took me so long to even get that. It took me way too long.
Yeah. Well, at least you're laughing. All right, go ahead, Panda.
I was in this bedroom with my brother and my cousin. Both of them are less pansies than I am, but still have some pansy tendencies when it comes to creatures and creepy crawlers. And I swear to God, I've never seen a centipede as big as the one I saw crawling on this wall directly across. Like, we were right next to it. All of us simultaneously jump on the bed together because we're terrified. This thing had to have been, I don't know, what's the distance of like two hands put together?
Depends on the hands.
The hands, yeah. I've got.
You have small hands. I don't know, like a foot.
10 inches.
Okay. a foot and a half.
10 to 12 inches.
I swear to God, this thing was that long. It was so big. It was so big. Or I was so little and it seemed so big. A centipede. Man, that thing was like, it was like they had a train. They had a train that centipede
trained. Was it near some nuclear waste or something? I mean, really.
It was near where we
sleep. Centipedes can get pretty big.
Man, that thing was thick, it was fuzzy, and it was moving. I've never seen a centipede move so fast in my life. That thing was skedaddling.
As they should with that many legs. So that...
Well, this thing had like triple the legs. Terrified me. Then I
so
go...
So it was a triple centipede?
A triple peed, yeah. Then I'm going fishing with my grandfather and my brother, I think, too. And the boat, like, something happens and it stops moving. And so we're just kind of, like, waiting in the water, waiting for Grandpa to try to fix this. And as this is all happening, we're just teeter-tottering closer and closer to the woodsy left edge, not the nice right edge where there's, like, nice beach openness. No, directly to the woods. I get, like, I start going underneath, like, tree brush, basically, that's, like, hitting my head. And then all of a sudden, I look up and there are just like swarms of spiders there. Get me the hell out of here or I will tip this entire boat on you guys.
I'd be more freaked out by the fish underneath that you can't see.
Well, speaking of water and things you can't
see. Okay, we're not going through everything you've dealt with in your entire life.
I lost one time I was also in the water. Lost, what are those things called, the paddles, the little paddle things.
Oars. Jesus.
Lost an oar, was trying to go through the water to find it because I knew, my brother knew, that if we did not obtain this oar, which our father had rented from said facility nearby, that we would be drowned in the lake, just like Jason himself. So we start skedaddling around into the water trying to find this oar. And I'm like, what is that? And I start feeling something with my foot. Bad idea, Amanda. You're in a lake.
It's a lake. They don't really have a lot of scary things. Was it Lake
There's
Placid?
There's a snake. A snake started crawling around my leg, dude.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Did you know snakes could get in the water?
Yeah, they're called water snakes. Yeah.
I didn't. I'm a young child.
They're actually called water snakes, yeah.
You know what? Traumatized.
Or moccasins. Could have been a moccasin.
Traumatized. I don't know what it is. I don't want to know. I left my brother. I don't know if he... I think he survived that day. I'm pretty sure he survived, but I left him.
I think he survived.
I have so many of these terror stories.
I think you focus on it a little bit too much.
Maybe That's I had thing. A cat who brought a mouse into my house.
All right. I think we're done with story time.
You asked me to bring stories and I brought the stories.
I think the mistake there is having a cat.
Yeah. Agreed, right?
Truly. That cat was mean and destroyed everything.
Let's spend at least an hour talking about how cats are the devil. Let's do that. We got some listener comments on this topic about in terms of like on our Facebook group, we asked, you know, what movies terrify you or what creatures, you know, that are real terrify you. Ants is one that comes up from Jason West. And he was Ants, which was made for TV movie. Could it be that one, John?
It might be that one. Yeah.
Okay. Well, he says, I think the Ant movies mess with me the most. Of course, the classic Them. But there's another movie where the survivors have to breathe out of a straw to outlast the ants swarming their hotel called
that's
Ants.
That's the one.
Is that the one?
That's the one. That's the one.
He said, it's one freaky movie. Nope. So feels like a right movie for you then.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay. Ty Nelson. We love them because it's easy to picture ourselves being in one of those scenarios. Maybe not as crazy as encountering a cocaine bear, but a bear in the wild feels like a real possibility. It is. I've actually ran into a bear before. Now, what terrifies me is anything poisonous. Not just the pain, but knowing what is slowly happening or having false hopes of being rescued. I'd prefer an animal, maybe a nice mountain lion. Just maul me and get it over quickly. That's hilarious. Tracy Cook says, one word, Cujo. Any animal that is supposed to be a loving, affectionate pet, shudder.
That's a good one.
Yeah, that's good.
That's a good one.
This is one I haven't even thought. Deb Salamoni Thomas says, I get anxiety around bugs, especially mosquitoes. I find a fear of sharks laughable. The smaller ones kill us with diseases. At least the larger animals get a meal out of us.
Mm.
It's good way to look at it.
You know,
we're feeding you. Yay.
One thing that gives me hope when it comes to sharks is that if there happens to be dolphins nearby, supposedly they will come try to help you.
Say what now?
If dolphins are nearby when a shark is like attacking you, or something, the dolphins supposedly will come and try to save you.
So the theory is if you're being attacked by a shark, hope a dolphin is nearby.
Yeah, do and see if they'll come.
I could almost guarantee if a shark's eating me, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to just be like, die.
Punch it in the face.
If a shark's eating me, I'm going to be making that noise mostly because I'm screaming my head off.
Yeah, exactly.
That's your death squeal.
Two more. Kyle Nolan, I am not a fan of any insects or four-legged creatures. They're either just really creepy or a four-legged Jason Voorhees.
Yes.
I don't know why I watch these types of films. I just can't look away. Maybe I just want to see the humans ultimately take them down.
Nah. I live that story, Kyle. I take them down.
It sounds like you run like hell is what it sounds like.
I also burn them.
Adam Smith, that's how you lose a house. Adam Smith... I think we love them for the same reason we love apocalyptic movies and shows. It puts us in the what would I do mindset. Mm. What terrifies me is the threat of the unseen or unknown. The idea of a predator stalking me in the jungle or underwater where they can attack at any minute and I can't see them coming is terrifying. That's very, very true. Remember that movie Venom in the 80s where it was like a black mambo snake or whatever it was, something like that? That freaked me out. That's really the only kind of snake movie that ever really freaked me out is the ones where they're like crawling through the vent and they just come down and bite you and then go whoosh.
That doesn't scare me, nor do most like land animals scare me. Like, I think if I came face to face with one, I'd probably be terrified. I know I'd be terrified and I'd probably cry. But I don't, when I'm out in nature, like if I'm hiking or something and I know that there's a potential for bears, I'm not like, oh my God, there could be a bear next to us. I don't think about it. It doesn't bother me. I'm like, oh my God, there could be a spider near me. It's probably in my hair. That's how I think. I don't know why I'm so opposite from apparently the majority of society, but I would much rather have a bear come and attack me and I have hopeful chances to get away.
You do.
Depending on the bear. Which one is it? Black bear?
Black bear are less likely to attack.
Fight.
But they'll no.
Wait.
That was in Cocaine Bear and that was wrong. You don't fight a black bear.
It's the brown bear you fight.
You don't fight either one.
No, one of them you fight, one of them you don't.
As an avid backpacker, dude, I promise you, you don't fight
there's
any
one
bear.
Of them.
You would not win. Whoever gave that advice is a freaking idiot.
You throw your peanut butter jar at him and run the other way.
I mean, it could be a cute panda bear.
If you surprise
bear,
a black bear and it charges or attacks, fight back with everything you have. If you surprise a grizzly or a brown bear and it charges or attacks, do not fight back. Only fight back if the attack persists. This is from the U.S. National Park Service. They know more than you do.
No, they don't.
How do they not know more than you do?
They're saying if they're actually attacking. If a black bear comes by, you know what you do? You speak loudly. That's literally all you have to do.
No, I'm saying if it attacks, that's what I'm referring
if
to.
If anything attacks me, I'm fighting it.
Well, there's one of them you're not supposed to. One of them
High
you're supposed
taught
to play
you that,
dead.
Man. Like anything Jesus. Bigger than you, you run away.
Well, you can't outrun a bear. Just know that. You can't outrun them and you can't climb a tree.
I really just want to throw her out in the woods and see this happen.
Yeah.
I've been in the woods, man.
What terrible advice are they giving on this stupid website? Terrible advice. It's terrible. I've backpacked 1,000 times. That's just... I'm going to miss, no wonder we lose so many hikers. All right, share your thoughts on this episode or anything else in our Facebook group. They probably give that advice to people they want to see disappear from their
park. Is that why I showed up on my Google search as the first result?
I'm telling you, that's not the answer. You speak loudly. And if they're attacking you, anyway. Share your thoughts on this episode or anything else in our Facebook group on Twitter at @BuyPopcorn, our site at thehollywoodoutsider.com. Email us feedback at thehollywoodoutsider.com. Rate and subscribe us on your preferred podcast app. And again, you can always find John's artwork on Insta and Twitter at @RJohnDraws, Amanda on Smirk and at @SinkIntoThis, Troy at Troy Heinrichs and The Blacklist Exposed, which is back now. The Blacklist is back for its final season. Troy and I are back on that one, so go check that out. And I'm also on Presenting Hitchcock, and I'm at Aaron Smirks on Twitter. That's it. I gotta go reach out to the Park Service now because I think they're trying to get people killed.
Amanda, just remember, when a bear attacks you, you fight it. And when that first punch doesn't land, you then stab it in the eye with the bloody stump.
I'm actually I'm actually a pretty decent fighter. I've been in fights before. Well, so good. I don't know if I can take a bear.
That's good.
But I think my punch will land. I'm a little insulted you think it wouldn't.
I'm looking forward to the female version of the Revenant.
That's right. The reason why, only reason why Leo survived that bear rape is because he's Leo.
Well, I'm going to have Jodie Comer star as me in the Revenant. Okay. I don't know.
Okay, that we're done. Now, that's going to do it for this episode.
You're not doing, you're not going to give my girlfriend anything to do, okay?
Your girlfriend, my girlfriend. Who are you, sir?
I'll fight you for it.
Fight me then. Come here.
I actually train bears for a living, so we'll see how this goes.
Well, all you gotta do, Troy, is apparently put on a brown bear costume, and she'll just sit there and huddle down. And
I'll
just
lie down.
Get in the fetal position.
Yeah, I know someone that has a brown bear costume that literally tips over vans. So yes, this is totally something we can do.
Honestly, just throw a fake spider at me and I'll run.
If a grizzly comes at you, that is true. You should get in the fetal position, but fight a bear?
You're supposed to fight a black bear back because they're timid.
They're already fighting you. They're not timid. For Christ's sake, it's stupid advice. Oh my God.
Even getting in a fetal position with a grizzly is stupid advice.
Well, I mean, supposedly that's the only way you can survive a grizzly because they will just kill you. They just for sport.
That's just because you want to make sure they can take you down in one bite. They can
all get me once. I don't want to have to be here anymore. Remember, the next time you head to a theater or sit comfortably on your couch streaming, buy popcorn. We just talked to each other this morning super early. So
radio.
Gaga.
Troy, that means you've done like 4 podcasts in 24 hours, right? By the time this is
over? Fuck me.
Seeing how we're all in the same room, why are you here?
Oh, I don't know, to be here, to be on the podcast.
So you had to travel a couple different states to go be on the podcast?
No.
Is that what it takes?
You're here for the film festival.
Oh, I get his question now. Yeah, I'm here for the for the Blight Film Festival. I'm on the board also, so I have to make a presence and all that stuff.
So you had
I know John doesn't make sense sometimes. But, you know,
yeah, like, you had to make a presence for a pretty the thing clear that question. You dragged Aaron into.
Yeah, actually.
Mm-hmm. Here we go. That's starting. We're going to do it like the old days. It's 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome to the Hollywood Outsider.
Are we starting now?
First of all, you weren't supposed to say 2 and 1. That's how they do it.
Say-
It's 5,
I'm sorry. I thought you
were,
you said we're doing it like the old days. I'm sorry.
What did I do wrong?
You don't say anything on 2 and 1.
Yeah.
Okay. 5, 4, 3. Can I still flip you off?
Yes.
Can I do that?
Yes, you can still flip off.
Yes.
All right.
2 and 1.
So this is the kind of stuff we do when we're not making video. This is awesome.
Yeah.